Good news, everyone! The oil price war is over, so we can finally go back to paying more at the pump again. Phew, I was worried? It's a good time, though, because I've pretty much tapped this oil joke well dry. On Thursday, Saudi Arabia and Russia agreed to record oil production cuts in an effort to revive the market from a debilitating coronavirus-induced slump, while America sat on the sidelines and said, "Hey guys, that sounds like a great plan. We're just gonna keep doing our thing over here. If you want our companies to cut their production, start calling investors." Yes, somehow America has continued to stay off of OPEC's production cuts email list. Oh yeah, our email is whitehouse@hotmail.com. Yeah, send your plans there. There's a large Mexican asterisk to that last statement, but we'll get to that in a few minutes. Today, my goal is to briefly explain what led to the oil price war and use that to explain the significance of this outcome. First, what happened? Well, as you can imagine, over the past month, oil has been about as valued as the opinions of anti-vaxxers. Something about most of the population not leaving their house is not conducive to massive oil sales. To deal with this, a month ago, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries met to discuss production cuts to keep prices up during this period of low demand. Although, as you can imagine based on the fact that this video exists, that meeting blew up like an oil barrel in a video game.
Oil prices have been on a steady decline since the outbreak of coronavirus in China as travel restrictions and contagion fears hit demand for crude. The latest crash, though, is the result of a failed agreement between the OPEC oil cartel and its ally Russia. The deal to implement new production cuts fell apart over the weekend, leading the Saudis to slash prices while ramping up production, sparking fears of an all-out price war in crude.
Russia was the first to break, saying, "We'll keep the current production cuts in place, but we're not cutting more than that. We need the sales." To this, Saudi Arabia replied, "Want to play ball? Well, alright, screw you guys, we're gonna boost production and sell our oil at a discount. Ha, good luck selling all that extra oil you guys are pumping now." To understand Russia's perspective, we have to mention a country most people don't think of when they think of the global oil export market. America. Ever since the shale revolution, America has become the largest producer of oil and is preparing to export more oil than Saudi Arabia soon. Problem is, the only people oil companies answer to are investors. America's private oil companies have been huge beneficiaries of state-owned oil companies, creating a false scarcity that we get to fill. So thank you, OPEC, for literally subsidizing our shale sector. From Russia's point of view, all this strategy was doing was propping up US oil producers at the expense of everyone else. Now, while it still made financial sense to prop up prices, it's like that one high school group project that everybody had to participate in at some point, where there were three of you doing all the hard work, and the fourth guy just kinda coasts along in the background. With that in mind, the stage was set for an all-out brawl between two different ideologies. You had Saudi Arabia saying, "Hey, let's all work together. America, you listening? Let's all work together to cut production and keep the price up." On the other hand, you had Russia saying, "You know, this whole free market thing doesn't seem too bad. We don't want to get your production cut emails anymore either. We're going our own way. We want to compete with you too." So who won? Well, status quo won, which means Trump got everything he wanted, no direct production cuts. Saudi Arabia did pretty well, dragging Russia back into the fold, and Russia, well, they completely lost. According to Bloomberg, the tentative agreement, which would be the largest ever oil output cut administered on by OPEC plus ministers, is coming without the US mandating curbs on its own crude production. So how did we pull this one off? Well, the first question is, did we pull this one off? A lot of this deal currently hinged on another country most people don't think of when they think of oil producers.
Oil taking a dive, crude prices falling yesterday after Mexico threatened to derail a deal among OPEC plus countries to temporarily cut roughly 10 million barrels of oil per day in production.
Whoa, that's so out of left field, it came from the parking lot. Yes, the major oil producing countries have all shaken hands on this deal, but Mexico, they weren't having it. Mexico said Friday it had agreed to a deal after initially balking at a 400,000 barrel per day cut. AMLO said his country can only cut production by 100,000 barrels a day, but that Trump had offered to cut an additional 250,000 barrels from US output. Yup, let's all pour one out for the Mexican government. This is where this asterisk I mentioned earlier kicks in. That took me an embarrassingly long time to Photoshop. Now this leads to a new question. How is America gonna legally cut our production to help Mexico? Start asking questions like this and this video can soon turn into a Pandora's unboxing video. While Mexico and pretty much every other country have state-owned oil companies, America's are privately owned. There are a ton of laws preventing the government to demand private industry cut production, and even more laws preventing private industries to coordinate production cuts in order to artificially boost prices. Now there are two ways to approach this problem. First, you could tap into your inner liberal. No drilling on public lands, no drilling offshores, heck, maybe even ban fracking. That'll drop that number right down in a totally legal way. This, unsurprisingly, is not the strategy Trump is taking. Trump is instead taking the strategy of complete inaction. Now this may seem weird considering that he just committed to cutting oil output by 250 barrels a day, but have you met this guy? Read the fine print when you agree with him. The administration's argument that nothing is the best strategy for production cuts goes as follows.
The United States says its output fell because of the price war and decreasing demand.
It's brilliant in its simplicity. The free market is cutting our production. Shale companies have paused production and slowed output. So yeah, that's what you wanted, right, Saudi Arabia? According to Trump, the cuts are automatic if you are a believer in markets. US oil production already has been cut back automatically. I mean, it's kinda true. We have cut more oil production than Saudi Arabia and Russia did during this fight, and it's continuing to shrink. It's just not public policy. Because of this argument, we were able to continue to avoid making OPEC-sanctioned production cuts, and those Mexican cuts, just put them on our tab. The US agreed to fill in the gap and cut its production, which we've already done, by the way, Trump said. The whole oil war seems like it's about to be neatly wrapped up. But before we can slap a bow on this box, one final question needs to be answered. Is OPEC going to accept this creative accounting? This is exactly why this video is taking so long to write. It's Saturday at 1 o'clock and I'm just riding that refresh button for a conclusion to this video. Now it's Sunday and I'm probably the reason there's a spike in searching for OPEC yesterday. OPEC and its allies are set to hold an emergency conference call today as it inches closer to resolve a standoff between Saudi Arabia and Mexico that threatens to unravel a multinational agreement to help reverse an oil price route. And we have a deal! The eagle has landed! OPEC Plus will cut 9.7 million barrels a day, just below the initial proposal of 10 million barrels. The US, Brazil, and Canada will contribute another 3.7 million barrels as their production declines. And Mexico appeared to have won a diplomatic victory as it will only be required to cut 100,000 barrels, less than its prorated share. So that's exactly what went on over this roller coaster of a weekend. Thank you, and that actually might be all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube! First, I'd like to thank my patrons for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the overlooked, join this growing list of exceptional individuals by clicking on that link in the description. Also remember to subscribe and ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring. Give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw, and lastly, as always, thank you for watching.